go ahead and give you a little preview. Alex is going to be talking about serving today. And what amazed me this morning was during our prayer session, Noah had actually, he brought up a good point. He was like, thank you, Lord, for the food in our fridge, the food that we can eat in our fridge. And yesterday I was blessed to go ahead and visit a food bank with my work, and it's amazing how much they need volunteers. So if you're looking for a place to serve, that's definitely a wonderful place to serve. And if you want any more information, you can go ahead and talk to me after church. I'd love to talk to you guys about that. But if Jesus was our ultimate example, then we are to follow him. And he lived to serve. That's all he did. He served us. He served his disciples when he washed their feet as a sign of servanthood. So I just want to encourage you all to just remember that theme for today. And let's just go ahead and praise the Lord.
Your home.
Lydia said, we'll be talking about, Alex will be talking about serving today. And one thing, as Alex talked about last Sunday, that we've started praying about is revival for our church. And as we sing this next song, I just think about, you know, how revival in this church really starts with individual revival in our hearts. And, you know, one of the best ways, one of the best things we can pray to the Lord is, God, just empty me of myself and fill me with you. Because, you know, even on our best day, we're still sinful and we're still just selfish and, you know, just sinful. And so we need him. And so as we sing this next song, let's just sing it out to him as our prayer. Not just today, but every day, that God would empty us of ourselves and fill us with more of him.
Holy fire, burn away my desire for anything that is not of you.
Demonstrating his love for us, we wouldn't be here today. And so with this next song, let's just sing about that love that he has for us, and just that knowledge that no matter what we do, no matter what struggles we're facing, that his love is bigger and greater than all of that. So let's sing that out. Thank you.
sing that again. Higher than the mountains I face. Higher than the mountains that I face. Stronger than the power of the grave. Constant in the trial and the change. One thing remains. Your love never fails and never gives up. Runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up. Never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up. Never runs out on me.
On our heart or convicts us of or encourages us with. And so as we sing this song, you know, which says, I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in all of the one who gave it all. And that's how we should go into every day, right? We should just wake up like, Lord, whatever you have for me today, I'm ready. But I also just want to kind of challenge slash encourage everyone. In this song, of course, it says, you know, I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned. And many times in the Bible, it talks about, you know, praising God with lifted hands. And I think for some of us, we may feel sometimes like, you know, we want to do it, but it's a little uncomfortable at first. And even for myself, it took a while to get to a place, you know, where I was comfortably able to do that. But, you know, we're here to worship the Lord. And so don't worry about what anyone else beside you is doing, if they're looking at you. I sing with my eyes closed most of the time, so I'm not really looking at you all. But I just encourage you all to just be, you know, without abandon and just lift your arms up to Him. It's an incredibly, I don't know, it's hard to explain, just that feeling of just having your arms out. It's something so simple, but it just, there's such great power in it. And so I encourage you all to just try that today. And even if it's just a little, you know, you may not be ready to do this yet, but just lift your hands up to Him as we sing.
Stood before creation,
Father. Truly, God, we lift up our hearts to you, Father, and we pray that as you did, Father, may we follow your example. May, as you served, may we also serve, Lord. And as all of these beautiful songs say, Father, we just want to worship you, want to praise you, want to honor you, glorify you, and definitely follow everything that it is that you have ever done, Father. And truly, as these words say, like, what can I say? What can I do? But all we can do is offer our heart, offer our time, offer anything else, our services, Father, just so that we can follow in your example. So, Lord, I pray that in our hearts, may you ignite our hearts with that passion, Father, to just praise you, please you, serve, to make you happy, Father, to love you because you loved us and you are our ultimate example, Father. So, again, may we follow that example. I pray for Alex, Lord, may you just speak nothing but truth, Father, and may our hearts be open to it, Father. May our hearts be ever so open-minded to everything, Lord. May our hearts be just broken, Father, to hear everything and to understand, to apply it to our lives. And as Mitsu had prayed or had talked about before, may we actually do it. So help us to be obedient to you too, Father. I ask all these things in your son's name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, I don't know about you guys, but I love the nightlife. I love to look up at the stars. I love to look up just starry nights. Well, that's no different than what's been going on at Oasis. For the past 3 months, it has been nighttime here at Oasis. The summer months have been happening. Things have been very relaxed. But now, don't get me wrong, the nighttime was kind of cool in some ways. We had some meteor showers, and when I say that, I say we went to New York. We did a mission trip. Many of you sent us there. And then other ways that we were pretty cool during the night is the moon shined pretty bright at one point when we did a lot of school supplies for the school, hundreds of school supplies. So we did some good during the night, but guess what? Now that Labor Day's over, the nighttime's over. In fact, the nighttime's over and the sun is rising here at Oasis. It's time to wake up. It's time to get ready because I truly, truly know that God wants to do some powerful things in the life of this church and in the lives of each one of us as individuals. In fact, one of the things that's about to happen, and it's happening as of today, is Oasis 2.0. So welcome to Oasis 2.0. And you're maybe sitting there like, 2.0? What happened to 1.0? Where was that? 1.0 was just starting the church. And we've been at it for about 2.5 years, and we're at the point where we're like, okay, I think we finally get it. I think we finally know kind of who we are and what God's calling us to do. And now, Oasis 2.0 is launched. Well, what's Oasis 2.0? Oasis 2.0 is not different than 1.0 in the sense that we're getting rid of things. No, we just see areas where we need to improve, where we need to build upon. We are bringing in tools to help us be more and more successful as a church. In fact, what's starting today in Oasis 2.0 is the Give Where You Live campaign. It's a 4-week campaign encouraging people to give where you live. And as a church, as a bunch of Christians, we live here at Oasis. Well, what does that really mean, give where you live? What it's going to be talking about, guys, is going to be talking about this. Give where you live when it comes to serving. Trusting God with your hands. And then the other area that we're going to talk about next week, evangelism. Give where you live with your faith. 3 weeks from now, we're going to talk about discipleship. Give where you live with your wisdom, with your experience as a Christian, a little bit further along than maybe other Christians. And then in 4 weeks, we're going to talk about finances. Giving where you live with your trust. So I'm excited about what's going to be happening. I'm excited how God's going to be doing some incredible things in the next 4 weeks, 5 weeks, and even the next 5 months. Now, let me explain why all this is taking place. Let me explain what's really going on here at Oasis. For those of you who have been with us since the beginning, I'm sure many of you heard that 2.5 years ago when we planted and we started claiming ground for Christ, what happened was a bunch of churches came together and we said, listen, we want to see a new church and we're going to just go plant a church. We need someone to plant it. God used me and brought a lot of you along with us. So they said, okay, you guys go plant a church and for 3 years we're going to help you, we're going to bless you, we're going to support you, we're going to take care of you, and we're just going to love on you. And so for 2.5 years, that's been happening. Now, at the end of December, this very December, 5 months from now, all of that is going to stop. They said, we're going to take care of you for 3 years. We're going to love on you guys. But at the end of those 3 years, You're completely on your own. So in those 3 years, you better figure out how to be self-supportive, how to be sufficient, how to be able to take care of yourself, because it's kind of like a baby bird. It's either fly or die time, all right? So as a church, we need to make sure that we can take care of ourselves, not only because it's healthy, but it's biblical. And so Oasis 2.0 is now being launched, and I'm excited that you guys are with us on this journey. In fact, what I'm excited about next week, and I really encourage you to come, because next week, we as a church and you as individuals are going to be able to impact people for Christ at a global level from your seat. You're sitting like, what in the world? From your seat, you are going to impact people for Christ at a global level, just like that. We're going to talk more about it next week. I'm excited about it. And so come back and you're going to find out. So that is what's going on. Now understand that Oasis needs you. Oasis needs you. I need you. I definitely need you, because we're all in this together. I don't know if you guys have ever had the unfortunate experience of having to push a car down the road. Stinks. It's horrible, especially when you're the only one pushing. Have you ever tried to push a car and you're the only person? You have to push, and then you have to run up and grab the steering wheel and make sure you're going in the right direction, go back, push some more. You don't want to lose momentum. But how much better would it be if you had 9 or 10 people pushing with you in the same direction? Synergy, baby. It's great. It's beautiful. It works. It's so much better. And in that same way, I want to get everybody to the point where we're all pushing in the right direction. And the first way that we're going to start building off the momentum of the past 2.5 years is really giving where you're living. So let's talk about that. Let's look at what it talks about, because giving where you're living, or give where you live, is not, I don't want you guys to do it just because it sounds clever. I don't want you to do it just because, well, the preacher says. I want you to give where you live because it's what God commands of each one of us. It's what God commands of each one of us. So what I want you to do is I want you to take God's cookbook on how to bake better Christians and turn with me to Mark chapter 9, verse 35. I see some of you smirking. Yeah, it's God's cookbook. Now, just think about that and you're going to understand why I'm going to say it. Just look at your life since you've been a Christian. You see how you've been baked more and more as a Christian. So turn with me to Mark chapter 9, verse 35. If you don't have a Bible, we got Bibles for you. We're excited to give them away, man, free of charge. They do us no good collecting dust. But take your Bible, open to the middle, and start turning to the right. If you don't know where Mark is, you're going to hit the book of Matthew, the first book of the New Testament, and then you're going to hit the next book, which is Mark. If you hit Luke or you hit John, you went just a little too far, start turning to the left. You don't know where it is still, ask your neighbor or go to the table of contents. So Mark chapter 9, verse 35, give me an amen if you're with me. Amen, amen, amen. All right, so let me give away the secret recipe already. Let me just throw it out there, and then if you can learn this, if you can apply it, you can get up and go home early, okay? So here's what I want you to do. Take your bulletin, turn it over, and you're going to see a fill in the blank. You're going to see on the fill in the blank, it's blank people, blank people. Right? So we're not cussing people out, all right? It actually means something. And here's what it means. Here's what I want you to fill in. Right up there on the screen, here's what it says. Saved people serve people. Saved people serve people. I didn't make that up. It's not something man-made. It's a God-given biblical principle that saved people serve people. That once you give your life to Christ, guess what? Christ then grabs you, turns you around, and sends you out in the world to serve the world for his honor and his glory. So fill in the blank, saved people serve people. Just let that sink in for a while. Think about your life. Are you a saved person? Has Christ come into your life, saved you from hell, saved you from the punishment of sin? If you can say yes, then awesome. Are you serving? If you say no, then okay, we got to work on it. So saved people serve people. Amen? Amen. So Mark chapter 9, verse 35. We're not going to spend a lot of time here, but I think if there's one verse to really highlight, this might be it. This might be the verse to mark. So Mark chapter 9, verse 35, and just like it says up on the screen, here's what it's talking about when it comes to being a servant. Jesus called the 12 and he said, anyone who wants to be first must be the very last and a servant to all. Do you get that? That Jesus said, listen, if you want to be the best, if you want to be the greatest, you don't go do it on yourself. You just don't go shoot for the top right away. In order to be the greatest, you must first be the least. You must first be last. In order to rise, you must lower yourself. In order to increase, you must first decrease, is what Jesus is saying. He says, you must humble yourself and you must become a servant to all people. Well, what does that look like? How do I do that? Look at this next verse up on the screen. Matthew chapter 18, verse 4. Here's what it says. It says, whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Jesus gives us a very important ingredient. We talked about it a few weeks ago, that children were considered insignificant in the culture at that time, that they were really of no value as children. And so what Jesus is saying, he says, listen, if you want to be great, if you want to increase in this world, you must first humble yourself like a child. You must first mentally consider yourself to be not that great. Remember, like we said, humility is not thinking less of yourself, it's just thinking of yourself less. Putting others before yourselves. Remember the second commandment Jesus gave us? Love others as you want to be loved. Treat others as you want to be treated. Put others' needs ahead of yourself. That's why it's so hard. I mean, that's a hard principle. Why do you think marriages are in such struggle? Because it's hard, selfishly in our nature, to put our spouse above us all the time. It's difficult. Relationships are hard. But in order to be the best, we must first decrease. We must first humble ourselves. Why? Because saved people serve people. Saved people serve people. There was this Bible student in the Philippines, and he would notice that when it came time to clean the school and all that stuff, that whoever was in charge of cleaning the men's bathrooms did a horrible job. In fact, they just didn't take care of it. Some of you know what that's like, right? Walk into a bathroom that just stinks, smells, sticky floor, it's just horrible. And so he got upset, and he saw enough of this, and he went to the principal, and he said, sir, those men's bathrooms are horrible. They're in a pitiful condition. You need to go do something. You need to send somebody to go take care of it. So a while later, he walks by that same men's bathroom, and he walks inside, and he sees that the floors are clean. In fact, as he walks more and more in, he sees a man there with a mop, and he's like, oh, thank God, finally, the principal did something. And then the man turns around, and lo and behold, it's the principal himself cleaning the bathrooms of that dirty men's facility. And what that student realizes, he said, it had such an impact on him that he learned an important lesson that day. He learned that in order to be a servant, you must first serve and not worry about status. He said service over status. He said that had such an impact on his life that he no longer complained, but he always said, why don't I take care of it? Why don't I do it? Why stop waiting for someone else to do it? Why don't I take the initiative? So the principle that we learned from that little story is that service over status. Don't worry about trying to be the greatest. Don't worry about your own status in life and how great people perceive you to be. Worry about serving first. Do the things that God commanded of us. In fact, there's this scripture that I think paints the picture so well. In Philippians chapter 2, look up on the screen with me. Verse 5, it's going to go through a few verses here, but look at what it says. It says, in your relationships with one another, meaning how you treat one another, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ. So what's it doing? It's saying, listen, I'm going to change your mindset to be a better Christian. I'm going to work on the way you think. Because if I can't change your mindset, I can't change you. And so Paul, authoring this letter to the church in Ephesus, he says, listen, let me work on your mindset first. Let me explain how this is going to work. And so he says, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ. Well, what is that mindset? Look at the next verse. It says this, talking about Jesus. Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Do you understand what he's saying? He's saying this. He's saying Jesus is God. They are equal. They are one and the same. That alone is mind-blowing. But then he said this, Jesus humbled himself, he took on flesh, and even as a human being, he did not consider God his equal. He did not consider himself equal with God, but that he humbled himself to be less than God. The verse continued to go on, and look at what it says in the next one. It says, rather, Jesus made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. Do you understand how hard that would be for any of us? To leave heaven, to leave perfection where you are King of Kings, and to lower yourself to earth from heaven to take on flesh, man, that must be humbling. To realize who you are, but yet who you must be for Jesus. That he humbled himself. And it doesn't end there. Look at this next verse. The scripture continues. And I know it's a little small, so let me read it for you. It says, and being found in human form, referring to Jesus, he, here's that word again, humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Do you realize how humbling that had to be for Jesus? How humble Jesus had to be in order to die on the cross for all of our sins? Like I said, he was in heaven. He was in perfection until his father said, all right, son, it's time for you to go. It's time for you to be the savior of all humanity. So Jesus, being the King of Kings, lowered himself, took on flesh, born in horrific conditions, stinky, smelly, manger, stable, all right? And then he had to live a sinless life, and it didn't end there. Even though he was innocent with no sins, his own creation had to kill him. Do you understand that? That his own creation, the people he came to save, killed him. And he didn't fight back. He humbled himself to understand that it's not about him, but he's here for a reason. And he humbled himself even to the point of death on a cross. Death for each one of us, so that we, because of our servant, who is Jesus, do you understand that Jesus was our servant? Our servant died for us so that we could receive the free gift of salvation if we so choose it. Whatever your favorite restaurant is, maybe it's Cracker Barrel, maybe it's, I don't know, whatever. Now imagine that server comes to your table with a pitcher of water, and that server says, would you like some water? Now you have one of two choices. You could either say yes and receive the free gift of cool, refreshing water, or you can say, no, thank you, I reject that. Well, you don't say that, but you say, no, thanks, and therefore you reject it. In the same way, Jesus is serving each one of us. We either accept him and accept that cool, refreshing gift of salvation, or we reject Jesus by saying, no, thank you, I don't want anything that you have to offer. And by doing so, if we were to die right then, we would usher ourselves into hell. Not because God sends us there, but because we rejected the gift of our servant, Savior, Jesus Christ. That free gift that's open to everybody. And if you're sitting here today and you've never given your life to Christ, why not? You can't get there on your own. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 says that. The Bible also says, humble yourself. It says, don't let your pride get in the way. And can I tell you what? When you stand before God and you say, God, this is the reason why I didn't give my life to Christ, he'll be like, okay, here's the consequence. You had that freedom, you had that right, you could reject my son, and because you did that, you don't get the blessing of heaven, you have to go to hell. Again, not because God sent you there, but you sent yourself there by rejecting Jesus Christ. So Jesus humbled himself to be our Savior, to die on the cross for us, and look at the reward of humility. Look at what it says right up here on the screen. It says, therefore, because of all that Jesus did, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. Now listen, when we humble ourselves, God's not going to give you the name above every name. That's already been taken. That's for Jesus. But what the Bible does tell us is that when you humble yourself, when you serve other people, guess what? God will exalt you in due time. That's a promise of the Bible, but you first must humble yourself. And in order to serve others, you must first humble yourself. Humility is a difficult but beneficial principle that we all would do great if we just do for ourselves. In fact, look at this up on the screen. It says, humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. You're wondering, why am I not getting a promotion? Why am I not increasing in life? Maybe you're not humble. Maybe you first just need to humble yourself to think less of yourself, and focus on other people. And at the right time, when God's ready, when God feels that you're ready, God says, I'll exalt you, I'll promote you, I'll take care of you. Listen, God did not forget where he left you. God's not searching the earth wondering, oh my goodness, where is Tom? Oh my goodness, oh, I misplaced Rod, dang. No, God knows exactly where you are. God knows your place in life. He knows when you need to be exalted. He knows when to promote you, but he may be waiting on you to humble yourself. Humility is a powerful, powerful tool. And humility is important because, again, saved people serve people. Saved people serve people. You may be saved, and I hope you are, but you may be struggling to serve because you struggle with humility. I don't know if that's the case. You may have to do a heart check. But I think that I have clearly demonstrated the importance of humility and how we must, and I repeat, we must be humble servants for the cause of Christ. So if we're going to start living where we're, or if we're going to start giving where we're living here at Oasis, one of the areas that we're going to have to really start giving is in our servitude for the church and in our servitude of one another. I think that as I was reflecting on this church, and I can't speak for any other church, I don't go there, I don't pastor there, but I was thinking about, really over the last 2.5 years, the top 5 reasons why people choose not to serve in this church, and came up with 5 of them, and these 5 reasons are this. Number 1, people will say, I don't serve because I don't have the time. I don't have time to serve. I can quickly debate that, but think about it. You do make time for what's important for you, don't you? You make time for what's important. Those of you who are single, you'll make time for a hot date. You'll make time to go pick up your paycheck. You'll make time to go to the movies. You'll make time to hang out with friends. You will make time to do what's important. You will make time to get on Facebook. You will stay up late to search the internet. You will do what's important to you. Is family important? Yes. Is my work important? Absolutely. Is getting sleep and rest important? Definitely. But is your church also important? I hope that you can say yes. And I hope that you don't have that attitude and that heart to just say, well, I'm just going to take and take and take and never give. Because a lake that takes and takes and never gives is a lake that's going to flood and damage a lot of people around it. You guys like Kraft cheese? Anyone here like Kraft cheese? Kraft macaroni and cheese? Amen. Do you know that back in the day, it was James Kraft who, obviously the owner of Kraft cheese, back in the day, years and years and years ago, he decided in his heart that he was going to be the best cheese manufacturer in the world. And so what he had was he had a little horse and a little buggy. I mean, that's how back in the day it was. And so he would work hard and he would work hard and he would work hard, but never really produced any results. And so one day, he got frustrated, he pulled his horse and buggy over and he started to have a conversation with his horse. He started to say, he said, I think his horse's name was Patty. And he said, Patty, we are doing something wrong. We need to change something about us. Something's not working right for us. So he decided right then and there that he was going to start dedicating everything he did for the glory of God, and that he was going to start putting God number one. Now, you know how the story ends. We enjoy the benefit of Kraft macaroni and cheese, amen? But the story goes on. And later, years later, people would quote that he said this. He stood up in his church and he shouted from the top of his lungs. He said, I would rather be a member of this church than the greatest businessman in the world. And God honored that because he understood that service is more important than status. And because he kept God number one, because he served others like Christ served us, God used that humility and exalted him at the proper time. I think the number 2 reason that people, the excuse that people give of not to serve in this church is, well, I don't know where to serve. I just don't know where to serve. And you know, I'll give that one a little validation. especially if you're new. But honestly, if you've been here any amount of time, you know that every Sunday almost, I stand up here at the end of the service and I talk about places where you can serve. So on your connection card, on your bulletin at the bottom, you can tear this card off. You could look at it with me right now. But if you're one of the people saying, listen, I want to serve, I just don't know where. Guys, turn it over. It says, my next step today is. And below that, it says, I want to serve with. This is where you can connect in the church. This is where you can learn and say, okay, here's the needs of the church. Where can God use me? In fact, let me go through a few of these. You know what? Guys, how many of you enjoy hospitality? I know I do. Praise God. First place you go before the bathroom is to the hospitality table, right? And you get your coffee, you get your snacks, you get the first and the fresh. Guys, you know, and I'm going to brag on her just a bit, and I know already she's like, oh, please don't brag on me, but I'm going to brag on you a little bit, Jacqueline, because I love you, girl. And so, here's what it is every Sunday, Jacqueline will come, and she'll set that stuff up. She will take care of your guys' needs because she loves you, because she wants to bless you. I offered her one time, I said, hey, can the church help financially? And she said, no, I'll take care of it. She's giving where she's living. And so we do need people to help come and lighten that burden for her, even though she sees it as a blessing and as a ministry. That's a place where you can serve. Maybe you're like, listen, I really don't like to talk to people. I'm not really a handshaker. So greeting, as important as that may not be where I'm supposed to serve. Can I tell you what? For those of you who are good with spreadsheets, for those of you who are good with administration, for those of you who are good with numbers and behind the scenes stuff, we got two places that we could really use you is creative arts. Maybe you like to do graphic design. Maybe you like to do video editing and you like to add some cool little special effects. Man, praise God for you people. We can use you. Or maybe you'd like to be more administratively behind the scenes but have a great impact. You know, we had a children's church meeting on Friday, and the thing that the children's church asked me to talk about is they said, will you please promote the children's ministry because we need people to serve? And I said, absolutely. Now, the thing about the children's ministry and where Oasis 2.0 comes back into play is that, praise God, as many of you have seen, the children's ministry is growing. And one of the areas that is growing is we're going to be starting a nursery, I think next week. But praise God, we're going to be starting a nursery. And many moms are like, oh, thank God, finally. Right? Because they need a time to be refreshed. Now understand that children's ministry is not a place of just glorified babysitters. No, absolutely not. Understand how important that ministry is. Because I believe that the best teachers should not be so much with the adults, but with the kids. Because if the kids are our future and the most impressionable age to give your life to Christ is a child, then let's put our best teachers with the kids. Understand that when you serve in the children's ministry, you are giving the parents a time to come, sit in church, be refreshed, be refueled, and be fed so that they can turn around and feed their families Monday through Saturday. So it's not glorified babysitting, but it's actually significant ministry. And there's other places, the music team, prayer team. Man, we're going to be talking about outreach and evangelism, discipleship, those things. So if you're looking for a place to serve, guys, right there. Or maybe you're like, listen, I don't know where to fill out. Write in the prayer request part, say, hey, please call me. I want to serve. I just don't know where. Take your card, put it in that box right over there that says giving box, and it will get to me, and I will make sure that I call you, email you, text you, whatever you prefer, and we'll make that happen. So there is definitely a place to give where you live here at Oasis. The other ways that I think that people make excuses, they say, well, I live too far from Oasis. No, you don't. You don't live too far to serve, because let me tell you about the people who live the furthest away. Bethany, helping out with our children's ministry, she lives like 45 minutes east of here, and yet she's here every Sunday setting up children's ministry, helping out. Joe, he lives 40 minutes east of here, and yet every Sunday he's here helping set up, getting the tech ready. We have 4 or 5 people from Crucis. They drive 40 minutes every Sunday who help out with our music team, Zach, Lydia, Sean, Austin. And guess what? They wake up about 5:36 every Sunday morning. They make sure that they're at the storage unit at 7:30. They load all the stuff up, and then they have to be at the school by 8 because Alfredo leaves at 8:15, and he'll lock up if we're not here. So they don't have the luxury of being late. So if any of us say, well, I can't serve because I live too far, no, you don't. Because the furthest people that that go to this church are actually some of the hardest working people. So that's another excuse that doesn't fly. Another excuse that I hear is, well, I help out with the chairs. Well, thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. But as you know, we all help out with the chairs. There's a difference between helping and serving. Now, I appreciate you helping with the chairs, but where are you serving that makes a significant difference in this church, in the lives of other people? That's my question. The fifth thing is, and this is probably more true than I'd like to admit of people, but I've heard this one is, I just straight up don't want to serve. I just straight up don't want to serve. People have told me that. I don't press, I don't pry. But you know what I hear when they say that is they say, I want to be lazy and I want to be selfish. That's what I'm hearing. And when they say that, you know what they're saying is they're saying, I'd rather sin. Well, Alex, what do you mean it's a sin? Well, I didn't make that up, but look up on the screen here. Look at what Galatians chapter 5, verse 13 says. Paul's writing, he says, my brothers and sisters, you were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh, rather serve one another humbly in love. What was he saying? He was saying this. He was saying, in Christ, you are free. You have been made free because of your relationship with Christ. But don't let that relationship be taken advantage of. Don't let that freedom become lazy. Actually turn around and serve people in humble humility. There is a rule, and I pray to God that it doesn't happen at this church. I pray to God so often. But if you look at a lot of churches, this is the norm. It's the 80-20 rule. And what the 80-20 rule means is it says that 80% of the work is done by 20% of the people. Think about that. 80% of the work is done by 20% of the people. I don't think we're there, and pray to God we never get there. But what that means, if you flip the numbers, is that 80% of the people only do 20% of the work. You can go to some churches and you'll find that statistic true, but pray to God it never happens here. Imagine if everybody at this church decided not to serve next Sunday. Just imagine, what would that look like? You'd drive up to church, there'd be no signs. No one would open the door and greet you with a smile, and no one would hand you a bulletin. No great kids to run and chase you down the parking lot and say hello. You'd walk in and there'd be no coffee, no tea, no refreshments. You'd either sit on the floor or you'd have to find your own chair. You'd be like, well, who's going to preach today? Well, Alex is going to preach. I'm like, no, I'm not. Preach to yourself. I ain't working today. And then the kids would be running around. You'd be like, hey, is somebody going to take care of that? And then we'd be like, you take care of it. I'm not lifting a finger. I ain't serving. I'm not helping out. How pitiful of a church would that be? We'd be the most pitiful church on the planet. But flip the script. Imagine if everybody in this church began to serve. Imagine if everybody began to serve. What kind of church would that be? Do you know how powerful of a church we would be? That's the kind of church I think everybody wants to attend. That's the kind of church we can be. But I need you to join with me in pushing Oasis in the right direction, because we're all in this together. Guys, like it says up on the screen, save people, serve people. Save people, serve people. Let me tell you this story, and then I'll be done. Almost. But it's not like 30 more minutes almost, okay? But let me tell you this story. It's about four people in the church named Everybody, Somebody, Anybody, and Nobody. The church had financial responsibilities, and everybody was asked to help. Everybody was sure that somebody would do it. Anybody could have done it, but you know who did it? Nobody. It ended up that everybody blamed somebody when nobody did it and did what anybody could have done. Then the church property needed some work, and somebody was asked to help, but somebody got angry about that because anybody could have done it just as well as somebody, and after all, it was really everybody's job. And in the end, the work was given to nobody, and nobody did a fine job. On and on this went. Whenever serving was to be done, nobody could always be counted on. Nobody visited the sick. Nobody gave to the church. Nobody helped with discipleship. Nobody helped with evangelism. Nobody ever shared his faith. In short, nobody was a very faithful member. And finally, the day came when somebody left the church and took anybody and everybody with them. And guess who was left? Nobody. Let me ask you, are you a somebody? Are you an everybody? Are you an anybody? Are you a nobody? Or are you a serving body? That's my question. As Christians and as Oasis, we can have excuses and we can have results, but we can't have both. We just can't have both. We can have the excuses and we can have the results, but we cannot have both. It just doesn't fly. It doesn't work that way. And so let me ask you, this very day, who are you going to serve? Are you going to serve God's bride, the church? Or are you going to spend another day serving simply yourself? That's my question before you. God wants to use you. He has incredible plans for you. He has incredible ministry for your life. He's just simply waiting on you. Imagine your life and look back on your life and answer this question. Who were the people for Christ that had the most impact on your life? Maybe it was somebody famous like Billy Graham, Ravi Zacharias, D.L. Moody. Or perhaps it was someone more close to home like a friend or a family member. Imagine if that person who had the most impact on your life in Christ decided that they didn't want to serve anymore or never really wanted to serve at all. How sad would that be for your life if the people who impacted you decided long before they ever met you that they really didn't want to serve? Imagine the impact that would have been lost. Imagine the impact that will be lost if you decide not to serve. Because God has a ministry for you. Whether you're at this church or any other church, this is a message that applies to every Christian. I ain't just saying that because I'm your pastor here at Oasis. I would say this at any church. Because we're all called to serve. Why? Because saved people serve people. I don't want you to give into the lies of the devil. Your Oasis family needs you to serve here at home. So I encourage you guys, give where you live. And let's start today. And let's start giving where we're living with serving. Music team, I want you to come up here. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pray for you guys, and we're going to pray right now, and we're going to do some business with God. But as the music team comes up, here's what I'm going to ask. I'm going to ask that Mark go to the back, and Buddy, if you'll be a prayer team. I'm going to ask that Phil and Lindsay, you guys go to the back, that you'll be a prayer team. Eddie, I'm going to ask that you go stand in the back, and if you'll be somebody who people can come to. Listen, if you need prayer for anything, if you need to give your life to Christ because you understand that what he did on us, for us on the cross was so important, guys, let's do it. Let's do business with God. Or maybe you say, you know what? I want God to start praying. I need you to pray in my life because I need to serve the Lord. I need to serve here at Oasis. Pray about that. Or maybe there's something else, a health concern, a job concern, a family member concern. Guys, the people in the back are there for you. They're there for you right now. Go do business. Go do what it is God's doing on your heart. And we'll leave the results up to him. Go ahead, guys.
There it goes. All right, I'm going to ask everyone to stand. And as we sing this last song, as we talked about before, I just can't stress enough just the magnitude and the greatness of the fact that God chose us. Whether you're a part of this church or any other church, we're all brothers and sisters in Christ. And, you know, God loved us first and he chose us to be his inheritance and to be his hands and his feet to this world. And so we're going to sing this last song. And again, as we did with, you know, the other few songs, we're just going to sing about his immense love for us and just be filled with that so that we can go out and serve and love others the way that he served and loved us. No ocean, no valley, no mountain too high, no power on earth, there's no distance too wide, no height or no depth could keep me from your love. No failure, no weakness, no doubt in my mind, no prison around me could keep you outside, no, not even death can pull me from your arms. Separate us now. And when I can't see you, prayer. Father God, I just thank you so much, God, for this day. Thank you for this word that you gave Alex to preach, God. And I imagine, even for myself, Lord, it's a hard word to hear, God, because even as much as a lot of us do in this church, God, I know that I fail serving outside of this church. I know that there are times when I fail in serving my husband, God. And it's just a very convicting thing to hear, God. But I just thank you, Lord, for this church, God. Thank you for Alex, who answered your call, God, and said that, yes, I will start this church. Thank you for everyone who's here, Lord. And I just pray that you would show us the talents and the gifts that you've given us, God, to serve you and to serve others. Lord, there may even be ministries that we don't have yet that you've set someone in this church to start, God. And I just pray that you begin to give us those visions, Lord, to give us clarity about what you've called us to do, God. And just let us be obedient, God, to whatever it is that you're asking us to do in the walls of this church and outside, God. And we just thank you, we praise you, we love you, and we pray this all in Jesus' name.